Welcome to the Heart of Health Live. There's a place for modern medicine in your life. Learn to use it correctly by getting your toughest questions answered on today's broadcast. Discover modern medicine's strengths and weaknesses. Lifestyle medicine opens the door to optimum health and healing. How you live and what you eat can profoundly affect mind and body. Learn simple solutions to complex problems. God provides the ultimate healing we all desire. He wants us healthy and happy. We just need to understand His plan for our lives and live accordingly. And now, live from Studio 1A in Chattanooga, Tennessee, here's your Heart of Health host, Dr. James Marcum.
Welcome, welcome to Heart of Health Live, where you are the program. And we want to encourage everyone. Today, we're going to be talking about allergies and another big word called immunology. So we want you to grab your friends and your neighbors. If you have a question, this is your chance. We have an expert in the field of allergy. Dr. Lee Perry is with us today. And if you have a question, we want you to pick up your phone right now. Dial 855-644-3278. Or you can give us a Facebook. You can do a Facebook question. If you're shy, want to go on the internet, you can do that too. We're going to be talking about allergies. And our phone number, once again, 855-644-3278. Each week on Heart of Health Live, we explore some interesting aspect of medicine. We look at the place where modern medicine has a role. But we also want to teach you ways that you can be more healthy and doing lifestyle changes. Some people aren't even aware that simple things like drinking water, exercising, eating the right foods can make you feel just wonderful. As far as the field of allergies, I don't know anyone that hasn't been touched by allergies. Now, there's some statements out there that we're going to find out whether they're true or not today, but some people believe that up to 20% of people have food allergies. But I think that might be a high number. Well, we're going to ask Dr. Perry that question today. Did you know also that the older a tree gets, the more pollen is produced? And I think we're going to learn today that allergens from different plants can cause allergies. And some people think that plants might even be attacking us. I don't know, but I'm not going to cut down any plants. And another thing that's very interesting is, did you know that pine pollen can travel up to 1,800 miles, or so it's been reported, in a very short amount of time. So these are all things we're going to talk today about, Lee Perry. So stay with us. We're going to talk about allergies. We've had a lot of questions that have come into our website. The first question that's actually come in, we're going to talk about after the break, has to do with peanut allergies. A lot of people are allergic to nuts. A lot of children are. We're going to talk that about our break. So if you want to join us live, give us a call. Our operators are standing by, 855-644-3278. You're watching Heart of Health Live. Dr. Lee Perry is our guest. We're going to be right back and talk about peanut allergies after this break.
Heart of Health Live will return in just a moment.
The ultimate prescription by cardiologist Dr. James Marcum is taking the nation by storm. People everywhere are learning what living a healthy life is all about. If you're happy living a drug-filled, pain-filled, mundane existence, this book is definitely not for you. In this book, Dr. Marcum dives into modern medicine's strengths and weaknesses and explains how lifestyle choices can significantly impact your health. To get your copy, visit Barnes & Noble or shop online at Amazon.com.
Hello, I'm Dr. Tim Jennings with your Mental Health Minute. Are you pregnant or thinking of becoming pregnant? Do you want to ensure your child will have the healthiest brain possible? Then avoid all alcohol, because as little as one glass of wine per week alters brain development and is associated with behavior and emotion problems. Avoid smoking. Children born to mothers who smoked had higher rates of learning and behavior problems and psychotic disorders. Take omega-3 fatty acids. Omega-3s promote healthy brains and higher IQ. And watch out for depression. Untreated depression is associated with delayed fetal growth and altered brain development. However, antidepressants can increase miscarriage rates, contribute to smaller fetal heads, and slow growth in the newborn. If depressed, consider transcranial magnetic stimulation, the only FDA-cleared drug-free treatment for depression with no risk to the fetus. To be smart requires a healthy brain, so be smart, do right, and make your child bright.
To learn more about mental health, visit comeandreason.com.
Imagine a classroom. A classroom with no boundaries. A classroom where reenacting a book is an English class, and repairing a motor is a math lesson. A classroom where caring for horses is biology. This is our classroom. At Bachman Academy, 6th to 12th graders with ADHD, dyslexia, and other language-based learning differences are provided a language-rich, hands-on program of study. With an average of 5 students per teacher, Bachman students receive more attention and have more time to learn while using their own learning strengths. Now, imagine your child in this classroom. To learn more about Bachman Academy, visit our website at www.bachmanacademy.org. Bachman Academy, tapping potential one person at a time.
You've got questions, we've got answers on the Heart of Health Live. Welcome back.
Glad everyone's joined us today on this beautiful day. Every day is a beautiful day, and I'm glad I'm not sneezing or having an allergy symptoms right now. I want to introduce to our audience Dr. Lee Perry. Dr. Perry, welcome to Heart of Health.
Thank you for having me.
Now tell me, what all the fields of medicine you could go into,
right?
What got you into allergy, and what does it take to become an allergist, a specialist in allergies?
Okay. Well, first I'll start with the second part of that question. When you're in medical school, you can either do, if you want to be an allergist, you either have to go through medicine or pediatrics. So you have to go through internal medicine first, which is a 3-year residency after 4 years of med school. I did 3 years of pediatrics where I worked with kids and took care of kids.
Okay.
And then I went into 2 years of allergy and immunology fellowship. So you do 2 years of allergy fellowship, and then after that, during your fellowship, you're seeing a wide variety of kids and adults. So now that I'm in practice as an allergist, I'm seeing everything from babies to 65, 70, 80-year-olds. Okay, we see everything. And as far as why I went into allergy, that's a good question. When I was in, I think my first year of residency, my intern year, my oldest son at the time, Ryan, who's now I'm almost 9 years old, started having issues with peanuts. That's your first question.
Yeah, we're going to talk about
that.
So
we'll talk about that in just a second. But he has pretty severe peanut allergy and also asthma. And those are two of the things that my field focuses on. So I had an interest there, and it just was natural for me to start kind of transitioning into an allergy fellowship after pediatrics because of those interests that I had.
And you see patients every day?
Every day, Monday through Friday, yes,
okay.
Sir. Yes,
so absolutely. You see, and both young ones and old ones.
Absolutely.
What's the youngest one you've ever seen?
Oh, wow. We see everything from literally a brand new baby. If there's some concern over immunodeficiency, sometimes we have some hints on immunodeficiency really early in life. And if that's the case, we can see a newborn. If it's an allergy issue, the youngest kids we see with allergy issues are usually in the first 1 or 2 months of life. If there's some concern over a milk protein allergy or something in mom's breast milk or the formula, or some concern over a food allergy, I know we're going to discuss food allergies. Mm-hmm. So that's the youngest we'll see in general. So 2 or 3 months of age that start having problems with their diet.
Now, what's the oldest patient you've seen? Because we have a lot of people that watch that are varying ages.
Yeah, I've got several patients in their 80s and 90s, either on allergy shots or on allergy medications, treating their allergies.
So Dr. Perry is very qualified to answer your questions. So give us a call, 855-644-3278. Our first question, Dr. Perry, what we do is we get people's questions on our website, and whenever we have quite a few questions on a given subject, I invite a specialist to come in and answer them. Because not everyone has access to good knowledge,
right.
On the internet and the newspaper, you can't believe everything you hear.
Exactly.
So a lot of people come to us because we don't try to sell anything, we're not marketing anything, we just want to give good people good knowledge.
Okay.
And the first one, this question says, my son has a peanut allergy, what precautions should I take?
Well, with peanut allergy, that's close to home with me because I have my oldest son. He's got peanut allergy. And first of all, the signs of peanut allergy, if you're exposed to a peanut or something with peanut butter in it and your child has allergy, they're going to have hives, shortness of breath, vomiting, diarrhea, any of those symptoms, usually within 15 to 20 minutes of exposure to the food. That's the definition of a food allergy. Sometimes you'll have a reaction up to 1 or 2 hours later, but usually it's almost immediate. And as far as precautions go, there are no cures for peanut allergy yet. There's some studies going on at Duke and a couple of other large academic centers where we're exposing doctors are exposing children, young kids, to small amounts of peanut powder or dust protein, where and slowly building up a dose like an oral in an oral fashion. So you start with a really small dose and slowly increase it, and are building some tolerance to the peanut protein orally. But that's far from being in your allergist's office or my office available to the public. We don't do that yet. So right now, all we have is avoidance. You know, you really need to avoid peanut protein or peanuts in all forms and fashions. Reading labels, making sure you read labels of the foods you're eating. Also, epinephrine. You've got to have an EpiPen, which is a life-saving medicine for a patient with peanut allergy. And epinephrine is an injectable medication that you can give in the case of an accidental exposure to peanut.
Now, what would you say is the percentage of kids that actually have these allergies to peanuts?
Yeah, it's gone up. It really has. We can talk about that some. There's some studies or some research suggesting why that might be the case. But right now, we think about somewhere between 3-4%, 3-6% at the most. Okay. Although, like you said earlier, some studies suggest maybe 20% of people have food allergies. That's definitely too high. It's more like 5-10% at the most.
Okay, so peanut allergies, you know, avoid them.
Absolutely.
Get an EpiPen.
Yes.
Find out if you have one.
That's right.
Okay, we're going to talk more about that. Listen, we're going to go to break now. Give us a call, 855-644-3278. We're with allergist Dr. Lee Perry. Don't go away. We're going to be right back.
The Heart of Health Live will return in just a moment.
Place for modern medicine, but that's not enough. There's a place for lifestyle, but that's not enough. The real truth in medicine, the real truth in healing comes from that relationship with the Heavenly Father. That relationship can show us the balance. When to use modern medicine, when to use lifestyle, and to use it for the right reasons. Well, this book gives the solution to the healthcare dilemma. It answers the question, why am I sick? How do I get better? And how can I have ultimate healing? I'm Dr. James Marcum, and I talk to patients every day who want to know the truth in healthcare. On our website, heartwiseministries.org, you can have your questions answered. You can read my blog where I talk about interesting and controversial subjects in medicine. You might choose to go to the radio or television sections and learn more about all sorts of health topics. Take the time and go to heartwiseministries.org.
Finding ways to keep kids active and healthy.
Works every time.
Get ideas, get involved, get going at letsmove.gov.
You've got questions, we've got answers on the Heart of Health Live. Welcome back.
Welcome back to Heart of Health Live. We're speaking today with Dr. Lee Perry, who specializes in allergy and you might say also immunology. And he's well qualified to answer your questions. He's got degrees and diplomas on the walls, and he spent time in fellowship. He takes care of patients every day. So give us a call, 855-644-3278. And we have a call coming in right now from Julie. Julie, welcome to Heart of Health. You're talking with Dr. Perry. What's your question this evening?
Well, thank you for taking my call. I just heard you guys talking about peanut allergies, and my question is,
you know, we see kids in kindergarten and we're planning parties, you know, this time of year and things, and we have to be so aware of the peanut allergies. When these kids are going to college, are they still going to have these peanut allergies, or do they diminish the older you get?
Great question. The textbook answer, or the easy answer, is they're going to still have it. In general, only about 20% of kids that age outgrow peanut allergies. So one out of five will outgrow it. That means four out of five will continue to have peanut allergies their entire life. So they're going to need to carry their EpiPen throughout the rest of the remainder of their life. And we don't know why. There's one of the things we were talking about before the break, or we were almost about to talk about before the break, was the rising prevalence of peanut allergy. We don't know why that's happening. If you work in the kindergarten or the elementary school setting, you know that there's lots more kids nowadays with peanut allergies than there were 10, 15, 20 years ago. One interesting thing is in Israel, they give a little snack to their kids called bamba, which is a peanut snack. We give Cheerios here, plain Cheerios, to 6-month-olds, 9-month-olds. They give bamba, which has a little bit of peanut protein in it, and they don't have any peanut allergy, almost none. So we're worried that maybe the AAP, the American Academy of Pediatrics, and some of the joint allergy offices and organizations in the country years ago came up with a set of recommendations that said, you know, no peanuts or tree nuts until the age of 2 or 3. And we really restricted kids' diets. And we're worried that maybe those restrictive diets have led to increased peanut allergy. We don't know, but that's the hypothesis at this point. But to answer your question, there's only about a 20% chance that those kids will outgrow those allergies.
All right. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you for calling, Julie.
Good question.
And that was a great question. And we have another question that's coming, someone that was a little shy to talk on the telephone.
Okay.
And this question is, she and her husband has moved to the area. The husband has cold symptoms that don't go away. Is this allergies or cold symptoms? So I guess one of the questions is, how can you tell the difference between a cold and an allergy?
It's a great question. Well, the cardinal signs of allergy are very similar to some of the cardinal signs of an upper respiratory tract infection or a cold. And those are runny nose, sneezing, itchy nose, itchy watery eyes, congestion of the nose, sometimes postnasal drainage. Those are all the cardinal signs and symptoms of allergy. If you add to that itchy watery eyes, then you get really the fifth cardinal sign. So if he's having those symptoms pretty consistently, especially since you just moved to Chattanooga, which is one of the hotbeds of allergy, Chattanooga is always one of the top 5 mm-hmm. to 10 cities in the country for people with allergy sufferers, or one of the worst cities in the country to live for allergy sufferers. So the fact that you just moved here and are starting to have those types of symptoms would tell me that you need to at least see an allergist to be allergy tested. The best way to differentiate, is this cold or is it allergy, is to get allergy tested. Allergy testing shows us if you have sensitivities to the things in our area, and it takes 15 to 20 minutes to find those answers. It's really easy. It's fairly painless. And we know the answer. With a cold, usually you'll have some fever. Allergy never causes a fever. So if he's having fever, then it's probably not allergy. If it's greater than 100 degrees or something like that, then it's not an allergy issue.
Yeah.
It's more of a viral infection or some sort of infectious cause.
So that was a great question. If you have a question, Dr. Perry's here. He's not going to charge you anything for his answer today. It's 855-644-3278. And if you're too shy, you can just leave your question like this last caller did. And that brings us, Dr. Perry, you know, there's certain states that are high in allergens, and I know this part of Tennessee is.
Right.
What are some actually good states where you don't see as many allergists?
Allergists?
Or allergies. I guess it goes together.
Mostly the Southeast is the hotbed of allergy.
Lots of plants.
It's due to the plants and it's due to the climate. There's lots of humidity here. So we see, not only do we see lots of pollen, tree pollen, grass pollen, weed pollen at different seasons, but we also see lots of things like dust mites, which are perennial allergens that feed off of humidity. So the more humid the environment, the more difficult time people with allergies to dust mites will have.
So you probably wouldn't see as many patients up in a tundra cold area as
in a dry environment, like maybe Arizona or somewhere like that, where there's not as much dust mites.
Stay with us. We have a short intermission. We're going to be back with Dr. Lee Perry, an allergist, answering your questions. Our number is 855-644-3278.
Heart of Health Live will return in just a moment.
The ultimate prescription by cardiologist Dr. James Marcum is taking the nation by storm. people everywhere are learning what living a healthy life is all about. If you're happy living a drug-filled, pain-filled, mundane existence, this book is definitely not for you. In this book, Dr. Marcum dives into modern medicine's strengths and weaknesses and explains how lifestyle choices can significantly impact your health. To get your copy, visit Barnes & Noble or shop online at Amazon.com. Imagine a classroom. A classroom with no boundaries. A classroom where reenacting a book is an English class. And repairing a motor is a math lesson. A classroom where caring for horses is biology. This is our classroom. At Bachman Academy, 6th to 12th graders with ADHD, dyslexia, and other language-based learning differences are provided a language-rich, hands-on program of study. With an average of 5 students per teacher, Bachman students receive more attention and have more time to learn while using their own learning strengths. Now, imagine your child in this classroom. To learn more about Bachman Academy, visit our website at www.bachmanacademy.org. Bachman Academy, tapping potential one person at a time.
Have you ever heard things about God that didn't make sense? Have you ever thought that science and scripture cannot be reconciled? Have you heard ideas about God that scare you? Or are you just tired and confused? If you want answers to complex problems, if you want a testable, evidence-based understanding of God and the world around you, an understanding in which the Bible and science harmonize to reveal the reality that God is love all the time, then Come and Reason Ministries is for you. Hi, I'm Dr. Tim Jennings, board-certified psychiatrist, and Come and Reason Ministries is dedicated to helping you learn to discern, to stimulate you to think, to help hone and refine your ability to know the right from the wrong, the healthy from the unhealthy, and teach you how to experience healing of your mind, body, and relationships here and now. If you would like an evidence-based approach to knowing God, then visit us online at comeandreason.com.
You've got questions, we've got answers on the Heart of Health Live. Welcome back.
If you've just joined us, we're talking with allergist Lee Perry today on Heart of Health Live, and we've been answering your questions, so you still have a chance to call in. It's 855-644-3278. And Sherry, are you with us here?
Yes.
Okay, where are you calling from, Sherry?
Tennessee.
Okay,
well, originally from California, though.
Okay, great. Well, what's your question for Dr. Perry this evening?
I have a ringing in my ear that I've had for almost 20 years now, and they told me it was due to allergies, and I've taken different allergy medicine from it, and I've lost some hearing in that ear, and I just wondered if that's possible because nothing seems to work.
Do you also have dizziness?
No.
Just ringing in the ears?
Ringing in the ear. They said it was a fluid buildup in the one ear, but they said it was due to allergies.
Have you ever seen an allergist?
Yes.
And did you have allergy testing done?
Yes.
And what did that show?
Strawberries, cats, but nothing related to the ear per se.
It doesn't sound, truthfully, it doesn't sound like an allergic issue. What you have is tinnitus, which is another name for ringing in the ears. And if you have dizziness with it, that there's also another diagnosis that kind of carries those into one diagnosis. But ringing in the ear can be a lot of things. You have a tube. Everybody has a tube that leads from their middle ear into their sinuses called the Eustachian tube. And the Eustachian tube, if you get fluid in that ear, whether it's due to allergies or chronic sinusitis or some other chronic problem, you could theoretically get the sensation of ringing in the ear or pressure in the ear or feeling like you're going up and down a mountain. You felt that before. But I would say ringing in the ear for 20 years is very unlikely to be an allergic issue. I would be more concerned. If you were in my office, I'd probably consult one of my ears, nose, throat buddies and have you see one of them to see what's going on in there. Is there something else? So ears, nose, throat physicians or ENT physicians would probably be a better place to start for that.
All right, thank you.
Hey,
very
Sherry.
Much.
Sherry, one question: are you able to function with this ringing in the ear?
Yes, I've dealt with it.
And you're not on any new medicines. You know, some medicines can cause those.
That's exactly
funny,
right. Aspirin,
those funny symptoms.
Some antibiotics.
I'm not on anything. No, I mean, I take, you know, like if I get a headache or something like that, but for any, you know, I'm not on anything regular or anything like that. They tried to say at one point, because a job I had for about 5 years, I did have a headphone in my that particular ear, but I'd switch it back and forth. It's my left ear, my right ear is fine.
Okay, well, you know, I think that's great advice, an ear, nose, and throat physicians.
I will try that. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your call, Sherry.
Thank
you. We have a question that's coming to our website here, and this is probably a quick question. And this person suffers from hay fever, Dr. Perry. They want to know, is there a vaccination for hay fever?
Yeah, it's a hard vaccination, may not be the right word, but there's definitely a definitive or curative treatment. Allergy shots is called immunotherapy, and that's where we take the things. First of all, hay fever means, in general, all the symptoms we talked about earlier, runny nose, sneeze, itch, congestion. Hay fever typically refers to fall allergies to ragweed, but it could also refer to springtime allergies or summertime allergies. And allergy shots are where we take the things you're allergic to, we make a little mixture of it, and we give you small shots, start with a real small dose, and we slowly increase the dose of your shot over time. And then we switch over to what's called, that's during your build-up phase, mm-hmm. and then we switch over to something called maintenance, where you get the same dose every other week for a few years. And slowly but surely, it takes away your allergy to those pollens or whatever allergen you might be allergic to, it takes away your sensitivity to that over time. Yeah.
So let's just start talking about what really is an allergy. What's going on in the body when it sees something it doesn't like?
Good, yeah. Allergies are, you know, in our country, allergies are very prevalent. In most countries, in third world countries, there are no allergies because we have this antibody in our body called IgE. IgE is a protein that fights infection in most countries. Mm-hmm. In third world countries, IgE is busy fighting parasitic infections and things like that, whereas in our country, we don't have those issues. So our IgE over the years has seemingly gotten bored. Basically, IgE starts to fight these harmless things in our environment, like cat dander, or dust mite, or pollen, or mold. And your body's response to those triggers is what causes allergy symptoms. So when you get that runny nose, sneezing, itching, it's because your body is trying to fight these harmless proteins that really it should just ignore. So when you do allergy shots over time, your body starts to lose its desire to fight those proteins.
Okay, well, we're going to talk a little bit more about what an allergy is after this break.
Okay.
And if you're out there watching, you have a few seconds to go to the fridge and get something healthy to eat. If you're flipping from one channel to another news, we want you to stay here and learn about allergies with Dr. Lee Perry. We're going to be right back. Our phone number, 855-644-3278. Don't go away.
Heart of Health Live will return in just a moment.
Have you ever heard things about God that didn't make sense? Have you ever thought that science and scripture cannot be reconciled? Have you heard ideas about God that scare you? Or are you just tired and confused? If you want answers to complex problems, if you want a testable, evidence-based understanding of God and the world around you, an understanding in which the Bible and science harmonize to reveal the reality that God is love all the time, then Come and Reason Ministries is for you. Hi, I'm Dr. Tim Jennings, board-certified psychiatrist, and Come and Reason Ministries is dedicated to helping you learn to discern, to stimulate you to think, to help hone and refine your ability to know the right from the wrong, the healthy from the unhealthy, and teach you how to experience healing of your mind, body, and relationships here and now. If you would like an evidence-based approach to knowing God, then visit us online at comeandreason.com.
So here's a question. If you love Jesus, and I mean truly love him, people will notice, right? I mean, if Jesus is at the center of everything you do, people will have to notice. And that is exactly what Life Talk is all about. You see, at Life Talk, our goal has always been to connect people to the true source of power, Jesus Christ. We know with Jesus at the center of our lives, nothing is impossible. We'll be right back.
place for modern medicine, but that's not enough. There's a place for lifestyle, but that's not enough. The real truth in medicine, the real truth in healing comes from that relationship with the Heavenly Father. That relationship can show us the balance. When to use modern medicine, when to use lifestyle, and to use it for the right reasons. Well, this book gives the solution to the healthcare dilemma. It answers the question, why am I sick? How do I get better? And how can I have ultimate healing?
You've got questions, we've got answers on the Heart of Health Live. Welcome back.
Glad you've joined us, and if you're just flipping through your channels today, tired of the news, tired of politics, tired of seeing all that stuff, you stay right here for a few moments. We're with Dr. Lee Perry, and you can join us, 855-644-3278. And before our last break, Dr. Perry, we're talking about what an allergy is, and let me make sure I have it right.
Okay.
An allergy is we're exposed to something we're not used to.
That's right.
And these cells, I guess they're white blood cells, an immunological type response,
right.
We attack it.
That's right.
And then we have all these symptoms. And I guess we talked earlier about peanut allergies. Sometimes it can be so severe that it could actually, an allergy actually kill you?
Yeah, the ones that are life-threatening are the ones to things like peanut and shellfish, some medications, and also venoms like yellow jacket stings or wasps or honeybees or fire ants even. These are types of allergies that can potentially be life-threatening in the right patient. Like my son, I talked about earlier,
right.
Peanut allergy could potentially be a life-threatening thing. Yeah. Absolutely.
Now let's go back. We have another question that's come into our website. I think you've already touched on most of this. That this person wanted to know, what are the most common allergens? And I guess that's a great question because a lot of people think it's just food.
Right.
Some people just think it's pollen. Are there other things that can cause allergies?
Yeah, there are. There's, like you said, pollen and foods, of course. And then there's things like dust mites.
Mm-hmm.
Dust mites are little tiny microscopic insects that live in all of our beds. Sheets, beds, pillows, you can't see them, but they feed off of the skin cells that fall off of our bodies.
Oh,
okay?
Wow.
So while we're sleeping, little cells of skin fall off, and dust mites feed on that.
They're in everyone's bed?
Everyone has them. Sheets, pillowcases, it's part of life. You can't see them with your naked eye, but if you looked at your bed sheets with the microscope, you would see.
Wow.
So patients that are allergic to them, we recommend getting dust mite covers that go around the mattress and zip up. Same with the pillows. And then you want to wash your sheets and your pillowcases and all the stuff on your bed on super hot water once a week.
Can we invent something that will destroy these so they're not there anymore? I just don't like to think about me sleeping with a mite.
Well, living in a dry environment helps. If
okay.
You're in a humid environment, so sometimes we ask our patients to run dehumidifiers. You don't want to run humidifiers. If you're adding moisture to the air, you're making the dust mites happy. But other allergens, common allergens that we see, pets, of course, cats and dogs, and some horse allergy in this area, people that have horses. Molds are very common allergens. Cockroach.
Yeah.
Cockroach is a common allergen. And the most common food allergens are the one we've discussed, peanut and tree nut. But then there's also things like milk and wheat and soy and egg.
Okay, right.
Those are the big five or six as far as food allergies go.
Now, would you include medications as an allergens?
Absolutely. Certainly certain medications can cause an allergic reaction. There's lots of different types of reactions that medications can cause. And as an allergist, when I think an allergic reaction, I think something very specific, usually
right.
An immediate hypersensitivity or an immediate reaction to some medicine, like penicillin is the classic example
okay.
of that. But then there's also lots of other immunologic type reactions you could have to medications that aren't really allergic, but there could still be adverse reactions.
Yeah.
An allergic reaction to a medication is just like what we talked about with peanut. It's usually an immediate response to the medicine.
Now, I've seen some people that are not actually allergic to the active ingredient. It's just what it's packaged in.
That's true. There's and the preservative allergies as well. We've had some patients that come in. They've been on a blood pressure medicine there for years. And the pharmacist, for whatever reason, changed to a different manufacturer, and there may be a preservative or a dye or something like that in the medication that wasn't in the previous version, and now the patient's having urticaria or hives every day for the last 3 or 4 months. So we have to kind of dig for those details, and occasionally we'll find a medication issue like that as well. That's
so an
right.
allergist has to be a detective, right?
Absolutely. It all starts with the history. Patients come in, they oftentimes think they know the answer, but we have to really kind of do a lot of digging and probing and finding the answer, because it's not always as easy as you think it might seem.
So once you sort of clue, what kind of testing do you guys typically do?
Well, it depends on the allergen. For foods, we only do scratch tests. Scratch tests are, and also for most allergens like pollen, that's what when I said skin testing earlier, that's what I meant. We do scratches where we take a little tiny plastic pin and we dip it into the allergen, and we just barely scratch the surface of the skin, called the epidermis,
okay.
And we watch it for 15 minutes. If you're allergic to that protein, you'll see what's called a wheal and flare reaction, where you'll get a bump like a mosquito bite with a surrounding area of redness. The bigger the bump and the bigger the area of redness, the more potential you have for allergy to that substance. So we do that kind of testing to foods, mm-hmm. pollens, molds, and we can also allergy test to penicillin. That's the only antibiotic that we can test you for. And we can do venom testing as well to all the allergic venoms okay. that are out there.
Well, we're going to keep talking about the tools of your trade and how you learn about these allergies. And later on, we're going to talk about the treatment.
Yes.
We can't turn off this immune spot. So we want you to stay with us. So we still have time for you to call in. 855-644-3278. And after the break, I'm going to ask him if there's any test for dust mites, to see if a person's allergic to dust mites. Stay with us. We're going to be right back.
Heart of Health Live will return in just a moment.
The Ultimate Prescription by cardiologist Dr. James Marcum is taking the nation by storm. People everywhere are learning what living a healthy life is all about. If you're happy living a drug-filled, pain-filled, mundane existence, this book is definitely not for you. In this book, Dr. Marcum dives into modern medicine's strengths and weaknesses and explains how lifestyle choices can significantly impact your health. To get your copy, visit Barnes & Noble or shop online at Amazon.com.
In the small town of Elmira, New York, a boy was born into an all-American family. The odds of him achieving his dream in the fashion industry? 1 in 23 million. The odds of having a child diagnosed with autism? 1 in 88. I am Tommy Hilfiger, and my family is affected by autism. Learn more at autismspeaks.org/signs.
I'm Dr. James Marcum, and I talk to patients every day who want to know the truth in healthcare. On our website, heartwiseministries.org, you can have your questions answered. You can read my blog, where I talk about interesting and controversial subjects in medicine. You might choose to go to the radio or television sections and learn more about all sorts of health topics. Take the time and go to heartwiseministries.org.
Hello, I'm Dr. Tim Jennings with your Mental Health Minute. Are you pregnant or thinking of becoming pregnant? Do you want to ensure your child will have the healthiest brain possible? Then avoid all alcohol, because as little as one glass of wine per week alters brain development and is associated with behavior and emotion problems. Avoid smoking. Children born to mothers who smoked had higher rates of learning and behavior problems and psychotic disorders. Take omega-3 fatty acids. Omega-3s promote healthy brains and higher IQ. And watch out for depression. Untreated depression is associated with delayed fetal growth and altered brain development. However, antidepressants can increase miscarriage rates, contribute to smaller fetal heads, and slow growth in the newborn. If depressed, consider transcranial magnetic stimulation, the only FDA-cleared drug-free treatment for depression with no risk to the fetus. To be smart requires a healthy brain, so be smart, do right, and make your child bright.
To learn more about mental health, visit comeandreason.com.
You've got questions, we've got answers on the Heart of Health Live. Welcome back.
We've been talking to Dr. Lee Perry, an allergist. Some people don't even know what an allergist is, but I think that we've figured out today, if you have unexplained symptoms of runny eyes, stuffiness, but no fever, okay, and symptoms you can't explain, an allergist might be able to help you, and they help both young and old as well. And we talked a little bit about how you can tell if you're allergic to food, which I think about maybe 5% might be actually allergic to food. But all these things in our environment, that the chemicals that get in us and trigger these immune responses, and all the medicines, it goes on and on. Yeah. What are other type of testings do you do? And here's the big thing for me. Does your testing hurt?
Good question. No, the testing really is relatively painless. We start off with, for allergy testing, we start off with the little scratches, where we scratch the outer layer of skin, usually on the back, and we watch it for 15 minutes. And really, it's just a scratch. If it's going to do anything, it's going to itch. If you're allergic, it's going to itch your skin. And then in kids 8 and older, 6 or 7 and older, and adults, we'll sometimes go to a second layer of allergy testing, which are little tiny intradermal injections in the arm. They're not. They don't feel good, but they're not painful. They're not like real shots. And they're just cutaneous reactions where we go into the second layer of skin, the dermis, to see if you have a reaction. So the first set of testing we do on the back, sometimes we'll miss some of the allergies with that set. So we'll do a second set just to make sure we catch all the allergy.
So you have a bank of all these allergens?
We do. We have them all in our refrigerator. All the pollens and foods, we just keep them cool. And every time a patient comes in, we go through the panel. Usually we try to specify what allergens a certain patient might need. We don't test everybody to everything. So we try to gear our testing towards a specific patient's problems and complaints and symptoms.
Now, you've got me a little bit paranoid about dust mites.
Yeah.
Now, if I'm allergic to dust mites, can you test me for that?
Yes, we do. We do have the dust mite allergen in our office in the form of a little liquid protein that we can scratch the skin with. Absolutely.
Wow. Now, what percent? You know, you've said it's everywhere. What percentage? You see a lot of people with dust mite allergies?
In the Southeast, we certainly do. A percentage is hard to say. Yeah. If we test, if you just test everybody that comes in without respect to their symptoms, I bet we would find that 30 or 40% of people are sensitive to dust mites in our area. That's because they've been exposed to them their entire life and they have the potential for allergy, but they may not be actually symptomatic to the dust mites. So if they're not having the symptoms of allergy, then we don't treat the symptoms.
Can you tell by their skin test how sensitive they will be?
Usually you can. Most people will have, or depending on the size of the wheel and flare. So you'll have some people just a really small reaction. Those people are either not allergic or mildly allergic. And we'll have some patients that we have, 15 to 20 millimeter wheel and flare reaction, which is quite big, a centimeter and a half to 2 centimeters of erythema and elevation on the skin shows a significant allergy to the dust mite or to whatever the allergen might be.
Now, we talked a little bit about how, these foreign bodies, the body wants to sort of fight and rid it.
Right.
So I guess, would it be fair to say if you don't have immune reactions to things, maybe your immune system's weak?
Not necessarily. Okay. It's just a different type of immune system. A weakened immune system is somebody who can't react to or can't defend themselves against an organism.
Okay.
So a weakened immune system, when we worried about an immunodeficiency, it's somebody that gets lots of infections.
Right.
But you're right, and in one sense...
Would they have allergies too?
They can.
Okay.
They can, but in one sense, you're right, an allergy is an immune response that's an overzealous or too aggressive immune system. But people with immunodeficiencies can still have allergies, believe it or not.
So they can still have allergies even though they can't fight off infections.
That's right. That's right.
Wow. We're going to talk a little bit about some treatment here. We got some questions about, we've talked about these symptoms. And the first question, this is a medication that's used sometimes for allergies. And it says, how does the medication Singulair work? So let's talk about that a little bit.
So Singulair, the generic for that is Montelukast. And it can be used in pretty much any age from 2, or actually we start them in sometimes one year olds all the way to adulthood. And what it is a leukotriene. We're going to get a little scientific.
Okay, leukotriene, you're going to explain that.
Leukotriene antagonist. So a lot of people have heard of Benadryl and medicines like that. Those are antihistamines, where they block the histamine chemical in our body from binding histamine receptors.
Okay.
Whereas leukotriene antagonists block this cascade of events that happens when you're exposed to an allergen. Okay. So one of the things that happens is when all these cells start interacting with these allergens, leukotrienes are one of the chemicals that are produced, basically.
Okay.
So if you have Singulair on board, you can sometimes block the allergic response because you're blocking these leukotrienes. So Singulair can be used for both allergy to pollen and dust and those kind of things. It can also be used for allergic asthma as well.
Okay. Well, stay right there because we're going to come back from break and we're going to talk about different treatments that you can do if you're an allergy sufferer. I remember one time when I was in Florida, pollen, I think, got me allergic, and ever since then, it seems like it's getting worse, so stay with us. You still have time to give us a call. It's 855-644-3278, and we're going to keep answering questions off the website. Stay with us.
The Heart of Health Live will return in just a moment.
place for modern medicine, but that's not enough. There's a place for lifestyle, but that's not enough. The real truth in medicine, the real truth in healing comes from that relationship with the Heavenly Father. That relationship can show us the balance. When to use modern medicine, when to use lifestyle, and to use it for the right reasons. Well, this book gives the solution to the healthcare dilemma. It answers the question, why am I sick? How do I get better? And how can I have ultimate healing?
Oops.
Yeah, sure.
Let's go.
Moms everywhere are finding ways to keep kids active and healthy.
Works every time.
Get ideas, get involved, get going at letsmove.gov.
Have you ever heard things about God that didn't make sense? Have you ever thought that science and scripture cannot be reconciled? Have you heard ideas about God that scare you? Or are you just tired and confused? If you want answers to complex problems, if you want a testable, evidence-based understanding of God and the world around you, an understanding in which the Bible and science harmonize to reveal the reality that God is love all the time, then Come and Reason Ministries is for you. Hi, I'm Dr. Tim Jennings, board-certified psychiatrist, and Come and Reason Ministries is dedicated to helping you learn to discern, to stimulate you to think, to help hone and refine your ability to know the right from the wrong, the healthy from the unhealthy, and teach you how to experience healing of your mind, body, and relationships here and now. If you would like an evidence-based approach to knowing God, then visit us online at comeandreason.com.
You've got questions, we've got answers on the Heart of Health Live. Welcome back.
Welcome back. I'm with board-certified allergist Lee Perry. And he practices in the Chattanooga area. And if you have a question for future programs, you can go into our website, heartwiseministries.org. And in fact, if you want to follow our programs every week, you can go to our Facebook page where we sort of put previous programs on. You can watch our old programs on our website. If you missed this one, want to go over it again, we post it on our website. If you want to see who's on future programs, go to our Facebook page. That's Heartwise Ministries. You can be our Facebook friend. We're talking with Lee Perry here. And Dr. Perry, we're talking about some treatments. And we talked about Singular blocking leukotrienes, which is one of these big inflammatory meters. Mediators, but here's a great question that comes in to us about treatment, and it says, who should carry an EpiPen? So first of all, you know, a lot of people don't know what Epi stands for, so let's talk about that a little bit.
Well, epinephrine it's like injectable adrenaline, so it's a medicine that's used in the middle of an allergic reaction, if you're having a severe allergic reaction to something. And it's injected usually in the lateral thigh.
Okay.
And it basically reverses anaphylaxis. Anaphylaxis is a life-threatening reaction where you might have hives, shortness of breath, throat discomfort, airway compromise where you can't get air in. So it can do a lot of things. It can even cause hypotension where your blood pressure falls in the severe cases. So what epinephrine does is it makes all the blood vessels tighten up, and it helps the heart rate to go up and get blood everywhere it needs to get, and hopefully reverse this anaphylactic episode. So life-threatening reactions to foods like peanut and egg and tree nuts and shellfish, those types of patients definitely need to have an EpiPen. Most certainly patients who have had a reaction to a venom, whether it be a fire ant or a honeybee or a yellow jacket or one of those, if they've had a life-threatening reaction or an anaphylactic reaction to one of those, they should carry an EpiPen as well, and really at all times. One of the things we've seen, research study after research study has shown that the biggest risk factor for having a fatal reaction to something like that, whether it be a food or a stinging insect, is not having access to the EpiPen. Either you've been prescribed it and you don't have it on you, or you just have never been prescribed it and you don't know what it is. But most of the time, it's patients who've had it and been prescribed and have seen an allergist that just don't carry their EpiPen. They don't take their allergy to whatever it is seriously. And if you do that, you're running the risk of potentially a fatal reaction.
So what's one look like?
It's about the size of a It's a little bit bigger than a pin you write with.
Okay.
Probably about an inch in diameter and about 6 inches long. And it comes in a little case. You take it out of the case, and it's got a protective device where if you don't pull the protective cap out, the medicine won't work. So once you take the protective cap out, it's alive, and you can go through the clothing or without. You can take your pants down and do it just in the thigh, or you can do it through the clothing. And it administers a needle into the lateral thigh, and the medicine is injected in over about 8 to 10 seconds. And then we tell our patients, if you ever have to use your EpiPen, it buys you about 15 to 30 minutes. You don't want to just assume you're out of the woods. You want to immediately go to the emergency room, because a significant percentage of patients will have to have a second dose of epinephrine.
So it can wear off.
It can.
So I guess an epinephrine pen to an allergist is sort of equivalent to a defibrillator for a cardiologist.
That's exactly right. It's life-saving. We prescribe them literally several times a day for our patients. Wow.
And I guess the scary thing is that, you know, younger people need these EpiPens.
Yeah, absolutely. And they make an EpiPen Junior for those patients that are less than 25 kilograms, less than 50 pounds, mm-hmm. EpiPen Junior. And then the bigger kids and adults, we prescribe an EpiPen. They usually come in a twin pack, which is good, because like I just said, some patients need a second dose. So what if you're an hour away from an emergency room? You give yourself the first dose, and then you start heading to the emergency room. 20 or 30 minutes later, you might need to administer a second dose. So usually I prescribe them in a set of two, just as a precaution.
And you need a prescription for that.
You do.
Yeah, because it can cause some bad things too.
Right.
Okay. Now listen, we have a little bit more time left. We talked about all the symptoms that people get when they get allergies and allergic things. You talked about some permanent things they can do when, mm-hmm. you know, sensitivities type training, but what are some things that you give that just help the symptoms?
Right. When we're treating allergies, the three things you try to do, number one is you try to avoid what you can. So like the dust mite precautions mm-hmm. we talked about, if you have pet allergy, you want to try to avoid sleeping with your cat or your dog or whatever. So avoidance doesn't always work with things like pollen and mold. You can't really avoid it. Like you said earlier, we talked off air, pine tree pollen flies hundreds of miles and tree pollen flies hundreds of miles. So even if you cut all the trees down in your neighborhood, you can't avoid pollen. So the second tier of treatment is usually the medications we prescribe. In general, we like to use antihistamines, which in general are over-the-counter, things like cetirizine,
okay.
which is generic for Zyrtec, or fexofenadine, which is generic for Allegra. Allegra is made right here in Chattanooga. Those are the best antihistamines on the market, and they're both over-the-counter. And then we prescribe things like Singulair and usually nasal sprays, which are pretty harmless. They can cause some side effects if you use them incorrectly, but if you use them correctly, they're pretty benign. And those are the prescriptions we have, prescription nasal steroid sprays and nasal antihistamines. And sometimes we have patients on a combination of all those things.
You know, when I expose to orange blossoms, I have all these symptoms. I think I'm going to die. I use some nasal steroids, mm-hmm. and it seems to get me feeling better.
Right.
We're going to be back. We have one last segment. We're going to talk to Dr. Perry, and he's going to look at you and tell you what you have to know regarding allergies. So stay with us on Heart of Health Live with Dr. Lee Perry. We're going to be right back after this short break.
The Heart of Health Live will return in just a moment.
I'm Dr. James Marcum, and I talk to patients every day who want to know the truth in healthcare. On our website, heartwiseministries.org, you can have your questions answered. You can read my blog where I talk about interesting and controversial subjects in medicine. You might choose to go to the radio or television sections and learn more about all sorts of health topics. Take the time and go to heartwiseministries.org.
So here's a question. If you love Jesus, and I mean truly love him, people will notice, right? I mean, if Jesus is at the center of everything you do, people will have to notice. And that is exactly what LifeTalk is all about. You see, at LifeTalk, our goal has always been to connect people to the true source of power, Jesus Christ. We know with Jesus at the center of our lives, nothing is impossible.
Place for modern medicine, but that's not enough. There's a place for lifestyle, but that's not enough. The real truth in medicine, the real truth in healing comes from that relationship with the Heavenly Father. That relationship can show us the balance. When to use modern medicine, when to use lifestyle, and to use it for the right reasons. Well, this book gives the solution to the healthcare dilemma. It answers the question, why am I sick? How do I get better? And how can I have ultimate healing?
In the small town of Elmira, New York, a boy was born into an all-American family. The odds of him achieving his dream in the fashion industry? 1 in 23 million. The odds of having a child diagnosed with autism? 1 in 88. I am Tommy Hilfiger, and my family is affected by autism. Learn more at autismspeaks.org/signs.
You've got questions, we've got answers on the Heart of Health Live. Welcome back.
We've been so fortunate enough to have Dr. Lee Perry, an allergist, share with us tons of experience, and there's nothing like being on the front lines. So since Dr. Perry's on the front lines, I want him to talk to everyone that might be viewing out there, and just what are some things that you really want to share before we wrap up this evening?
I think the biggest thing, the biggest take-home message from when you're talking about allergies is all the misconceptions there are about allergy. You really want to, if there's any doubt, there's so many well-meaning physicians, even MDs, that are out there practicing allergy, or having, you know, that may say they have an expertise in the field of allergy. When allergy, you know, it's a complex thing. You want to make sure if there's any concern over an allergy, over a medication, or a food, or even an environmental allergen, you want to make sure you're seeing a board certified allergist, whether it's in Chattanooga or somewhere, wherever you're watching. You want to make sure you're seeing somebody that's had that training in allergy, because if you don't, then you could be getting the wrong message. That would be my main point, is just make sure you're seeing a board certified allergist over these types of issues.
Yeah, well, another thing I've learned tonight, if you're having symptoms that you might be confused with viruses, I mean, it might be an allergy you might be having.
That's right.
And there's lots of things that people can do to help, and even maybe with these skin testing, maybe you can prevent these by sensitizing people, so if they can't get away from all the pollen, they might do better from that as well.
That's right, and it depends on where you live. If you live in our area, our neck of the woods, as you were just talking about, the tree pollen, levels in the spring are absolutely astronomical, and then in the fall it's usually ragweed. Summer it's grass pollen, so every season brings on a new pollen. And in this area in the southeast, it's all over the place and quite abundant.
Well, this is such a common problem. I'm sure you're going to have more questions in the future. You can leave your questions for Dr. Perry at our website. It's heartwiseministries.org. You can become one of our Facebook friends, or you can call us live on our program. We're going to have Dr. Perry back again. So if you have any questions in the future, just let us know on Heart of Health Live. Thanks for joining us this evening.